Building a great UI in Unity is not just about performance. It's also about making your game development process smoother and more efficient. In this video, we'll cover 7 quick and essential tips to optimize and streamline your Unity UI. Welcome to 100 Tips in Unity. This is episode 3, which is about 7 tips. Let's dive in. The 0th tip of this video, this one is for free, is to press 2 on the keyboard to switch between 2D and 3D view. A lot of people don't know this, so press 2 on the keyboard to switch back and forth between 2D mode and 3D mode to easily speed up your development process. This is insane. And tip number 1 is to actually split your canvas. By splitting, I mean you create a canvas specific for static UI elements. That means elements that do not get refreshed a lot, and a canvas that contains all the dynamic elements in your UI. In Unity, when you update any one of these elements, for example, if I animate one of these buttons here, all of the elements in this same canvas gets refreshed. What's happening under the hood is when I do anything with any of these elements, it makes the canvas containing it dirty. And making the canvas dirty would cause all of the elements inside it to refresh, to get redrawn again at the end of the frame. This is not ideal, especially if you want to draw things like the backgrounds or the game title. So it's better to put it into another canvas, called canvas static in this case, so that they do not get refreshed whenever I, animate or do anything with the dynamic elements. In this case, when I hover over the play button, only these 3 buttons, which are part of this canvas, gets updated. The title and the background does not get touched, which is great. Also, when you create a canvas, there's going to be a graphic ray caster added by default. For static canvases, you can actually get rid of these graphic ray casters because you're not going to have any mouse over events over them. It's just static. So that is also going to improve your performance. Also, for text elements, you can go to Text Mesh Pro's extra settings, and you can disable raycast target if your text shouldn't block raycasts. Following along with tip number 1 is tip number 2, which is nesting canvases. It is okay to put multiple canvases inside another canvas. It is optimized. You don't have to worry about anything. In this case, I have created a dynamic canvas. The health bar here is a canvas. The quest log is also a canvas. And the inventory is also a canvas. And Unity optimizes them so that all of these things can be run together. Okay? Whenever I update the health, the inventory and the quest log is no longer refreshed. It's no longer dirty, because both of these are a part of a different sub-canvas. By splitting your dynamic canvas into sub-canvases, you optimize it even further. This is something that is not a lot talked about in a lot of other tutorials. I will link below to a Unity documentation that talks about this. You must check it out, okay? It contains other optimization tips related to UI as well. The next tip is about scaling. If I choose the dynamic canvas, on the canvas scaler, set UI scale mode to scale with screen size. Constant pixel size is useful if you want to make pixelated games with a much smaller resolution, but I highly recommend making games on full screen, so choose scale with screen size. Also, make sure to have a reference resolution. So I recommend keeping it to 1920 by 1080. Also, set the screen match mode to match width or height. Don't overcomplicate things. And set the match to 0. To match the width if you're making horizontal games. If your game has an aspect ratio that is vertical, match it to height so that the UI elements scale based on the height. If you're unsure or if you have both, set this to 0.5. Okay, so Unity tries its best to scale it evenly. Tip number 4 is about anchoring and stretching. So if you look at my health and mana canvas, it's actually only occupying a small space within my bigger canvas. And the way we do that is by avoiding stretching. For any UI element game object, there is no transform. Instead, there is rect transform. And we have the ability to set anchors to it. We can click on this icon here to set an anchor. But if you notice on the side, there are anchors labeled stretch. In this main menu, my background image actually has an anchor stretch. This helps me set my image to full resolution. So if I go to stretch again, click on this and then press Alt and then click on that, it is going to stretch whatever I have to the canvas above it. This is extremely useful if you have backgrounds, but in the case of my sub canvases, I actually recommend choosing any of these. In this case, my health bar is on the top left, so I chose the closest anchor, which is on the top left. And because we are not stretching this canvas, we need to specify a width and a height, which is going to be the calculated width and height. You need to do this manually. So this is 500 pixels by 135 pixels based on my calculation. So the tip is, for your sub canvases or other elements in your scene, you can and you should put a width and a height. That is the tip. Tip number 5 is to avoid overdraw. You should try your best to place your elements so that one does not get rendered on top of another. This causes GPU overhead. You want to minimize it as much as possible. This could be one of the reasons why your game might be lagging, because you are rendering things on top of another. This means try not to lower your opacity, okay? This is bad. You shouldn't have translucent elements in your canvas. Tip number 6 is to create modular canvas elements. Take a look at the buttons here. I'm reusing the same prefab again and again instead of creating a separate play button, settings button, exit button. And I have a script inside this button that dynamically sets the text mesh pro text to whatever label text that we have provided. Plus, it also adjusts the button width so that it matches the width of the text itself. If I hit play, you can see that it changes to play, settings, and exit. So what is the advantage? This is one thing that not a lot of tutorials talk about. The advantage of doing so is localization. When you want to export your game to multiple languages, that is when setting the text via code makes a lot of sense. Okay, we are reusing the same button prefab and we are setting it via code. So you should get into the habit of doing these little things so that in the long run, when you make an actual commercial game, this is going to help you a lot. Okay. And tip number 7 is about layout groups. If you look at this inventory, there's an inventory panel, which is an empty game object. And to that, I've added a grid layout group component. What this does is it arranges all of the children on a grid, which means if I duplicate this, it will keep on adding to the grid, which is useful, right? Similarly, there are horizontal layout groups and vertical layout groups that allows us to arrange UI elements horizontally and vertically. But the disadvantage of these layout groups is that it's quite taxing. The reason why it is taxing is because it contains a lot of get component calls. Whenever one of these children changes or updates, all of these children are going to call a get component on this parent layout group. And if that layout group contains another layout group at the parent, it's going to, add up. So the tip is to avoid using layout groups whenever possible. The alternative is to actually set this thing via code. Okay, it's going to reduce a lot of these get component calls. It's also going to make your game more flexible. Plus, you could use object pooling to make it even more performant. I actually wanted to add object pooling to this video, but I thought it would be much more informative to add it to another video so that I can go in depth on it. So minimize grid layout groups. Instead, manually spend the time to set anchors and set the width and the height. Okay, this is going to take some time, but it's super performant compared to the other approach. Here's a bonus tip. Because you're stuck around till now listening to me rambling, and that is, do not animate buttons the way Unity suggests. If you look at this button, I've set the transition to animation. And in this, I've just increased the scale to 1.1 so that whenever this button gets highlighted, the scale increases. This is terrible, okay? Do not use animators inside buttons because it sets the canvas dirty every frame, regardless whether the animation is played or not. In this animator, it is always going to play a normal animation. That is the problem. This is terrible, as it sets the canvas dirty. Instead, what you should do is to actually animate the scale via code. This is going to also improve your performance of UI a lot. you might not be even aware that this is the problem with your UI because you're animating your damn buttons. But you shouldn't. You should not choose button transition to animation. Just keep it color tint or something like that. But animation, instead animate manually via code. I did not intend to share that in this video, but hey, it happened. So that was the end of this episode. Make sure to check out the entire 100 tips playlist. We have only 3 tips as of now, but by the end of this year, I'm going to be completing that. Let me know what you think. In the next one, we're going to be talking about curves, which is going to be interesting. Okay, so I'll see you in the next one.